No man is an island entire of itself. That's John Donne from the 17th century. And I think of him, oddly enough, when I acknowledge and welcome everyone to the land of the Kaurna people on which we are meeting today, and give them our respect for their spiritual relationship to country, acknowledging that they're the custodians of the Adelaide region and that their cultural and heritage beliefs are still important to us today and will be tomorrow. Value creation, that's our topic tonight. Everyone wants to create value, business, governments, universities, and indeed the arts. Does cultural value count? Or is it counted to death, as I read in a paper of someone who's here tonight? Do we need to defend cultural measures? And to what extent has value been lost, evidenced by things such as the Me Too campaign, with bad behaviour of arts board directors, arts managers, and indeed artists? Our keynote speaker tonight, distinguished Professor Ian Fillis, and our panel of speakers from the Adelaide Festival of Ideas, Sandy Fairshaw, the Australian Dance Theatre, Sean Comerford, and Regional Arts Australia, John Oster, all connect with communities to create value. What can they add to the debate? Tonight we're going to find out. Professor Ian Fillis has joined us as distinguished visiting thought leader. Thank you for providing us with the funding for this important initiative, Professor Tanya Munro. Ian visits us from the Liverpool Business School in the UK. He's a leading entrepreneurial small business researcher with research interests in creativity, arts, international marketing and consumer research, and of course value creation, where he's received a large a grant equivalent to the Australian Research Council grant to investigate that topic. Ian then is not typical of someone who initially trained as an engineer. And he often turns his back on quantification, although of course he can do the numbers. In his novel research approach, he's been recognised by his success for linking with industry, such as arts councils, arts ministry, national funding bodies, to name a few, and obtaining a number of large grants and creating knowledge for the community. Without further ado, I'd like to hand over to our Dean Research and Innovation, Professor Andrew Beer, who'll appoint Ian into our exclusive club of UniSA Distinguished Visiting Thought Leaders. Thank you, Andrew.
Thank you very much for the introduction, Ruth. Very kind of you. It's my great honour to be here tonight and to represent the Deputy Vice-Chancellor of Research and Innovation, Professor Tanya Munro. The Visiting Distinguished Thought Leader program is part of the University's Research and Innovation Strategic Plan, Partnered Engaged Excellence. And it recognises the importance of the university community and individual researchers and research students within the university community of looking globally, seeking new horizons, and finding ways to connect with intellectual debates and academic debates on a truly global scale. Visiting distinguished thought leaders are at the cutting edge of knowledge creation and dissemination. It is a great honour to have someone of Professor Fillis's calibre here tonight to share his thoughts, his wisdom and his insights on a very important topic, and one which really speaks to many parts of the business school here at the University of South Australia, both the arts cultural management component, but also small business, which is so essential to our economy. I'd like to call Ian up here so I can present him with the token of our esteem. Thank you very much, Ian. If you don't mind, we're going to do the traditional photo thing now. And this is now yours. Wow. And on that note, I pass over to Ian himself, I believe.
So I've got some formal notes here and slides, but I want to just start off by saying I'm just so delighted to be here. It's like someone asked me when I moved from Stirling University to come to Liverpool Business School what it was like. I said it was like a breath of fresh air. I think coming here is like, I don't know, like a hurricane, a tornado, a tsunami of arts and cultural experiences. It's been two weeks since I arrived here, and it's just been so fantastic. I've got one more week to go. I don't want to leave. So, maybe I think what I'll start doing is just talk a little bit briefly about myself and why someone from a little country like Northern Ireland is doing in Adelaide in South Australia. Okay, so. So I've got a background, as Ruth says, in civil engineering. I never practiced as a civil engineer, but I've got a number of different areas of expertise within the arts and cultural spectrum. Small business, marketing, entrepreneurship, and so on. But a little bit on consumer research. I've done a little bit on celebrity artists and consumption processes and so on. In the last several years, I've been leading a major project funded by the Arts and Humanities Research Council on cultural entrepreneurship, and I've just submitted, pressed the button on the JES system the other day on a follow-on funding project on impact and engagement. I can see how much impact and engagement has been occurring and will continue to occur in the city of Adelaide and the wider areas throughout South Australia and beyond. So, yes, I do have some funding sources from research councils in the UK. I've, in the past, also some socioeconomic surveys carried out on the craft sector as well. I'm also the editor of the forthcoming Edward Elgar Handbook on Entrepreneurship and Marketing. So look out for that one when it hits the shelves, when the final authors who are due to submit their chapters finally do submit their chapters, hopefully in the next few weeks. Okay. It's not the first time I've worked with Ruth. I was honoured to come to Deakin University a few years ago as a Bowater Visiting Research Fellow and so on. And I'm currently working with colleagues at University of Tasmania as well. So I just love coming here. It's my fourth visit to Australia. And I want to come back again. So. I'm not going to bore you with the details of the funding bids that I've secured and so on, but a little bit of flavour in terms of what I've done, looking at cultural value of contemporary art exhibition in Edinburgh, and if anyone's got any spare time tomorrow lunchtime, I'm giving a CBER lunchtime lecture. I'll give some more detail about that as well. So this cultural value project in the UK has been ongoing for the last few years, and I was delighted to see that it's also of importance here in Australia when I attended a lunchtime book launch the other day as well at the Festival of Ideas. A lot of what I do also looks at thinking about art as a product or a commodity. I know that's contentious for a lot of you in the room here, but I think that that's good. It excites people, it gets debate going and so on. And here are some details of other projects that I've been involved with in the past as well, looking at craft as art, as product and so on. So as an academic, of course, we need to publish. And again, I'm not going to dwell on these activities, but I just want to pay tribute to one of my co-authors who's also here, Boram Lee, who's also going to be starting work at the University of South Australia in the next several months as well. So here are some details of some of our publications as well. I've also been doing some work with colleagues at UTAS around that wonderful human being, David Walsh, and I'll talk a little bit about him in a wee minute or two in more detail and so on. I also do some critical arts marketing research as well, thinking about how we can use theory and practice from the arts to inform management and leadership more broadly as well. So, last slide on me. If any of you have been to Northern Ireland, this is a little harbour, Ballantoy Harbour on the north coast. It's where I thought I could sell my artwork maybe 28 years ago. And if you see in the background, there's a little cafe, and the lady came out of the cafe one day and said to me, "Would you like to exhibit your paintings?" And I said, "Yes, why not?" So she took some of those paintings inside, and I could then concentrate on my painting and drawing. 2 weeks later, in the local paper, I read that the cafe had been broken into and some of the artworks had been stolen. But you know what? I never had the courage to go back to see if my artwork had been stolen. Because if you can imagine, everything else is gone but apart from my work on the wall. So I don't know. Who knows? Who knows? They may be somewhere else. Who knows? Who knows? So, yeah, so what I want to do to address this whole issue of how to create value within this wonderful world that we live in, and in the British world of Brexit, post-Brexit, whatever it might be, in the era that we're going to enter into, I think part of the answer to all these related questions can be found in our work in cultural value in the UK, and then hopefully extending in terms of what we might be doing in Australia as well. Because we're in this collaborative grant application between Liverpool Business School and University of Tasmania, but I'd like to maybe extend this work in the future as well in the University of South Australia and beyond. So all of this has been made possible by securing funding from the UK's Arts and Humanities Research Council. The leader of the wider ongoing cultural value project involves 70 different sets of research activities. And the two main folks behind it, Krosik and Kaczynska, view cultural value as the effects that culture has on those who experience it and the differences it makes to individuals and society. It's a very powerful statement to make. It's an artistic statement, it's a political statement, I think. It's an economic statement as well. So I just want to run through very briefly some aspects of that project and then lead into a wider conversation on entrepreneurial creation of value. So this was the site of our research in Edinburgh. The Royal Scottish Academy, just off Prince's Street. If anyone's been to Edinburgh, you'll know it's a hive of activity, and especially in August. It's pretty unbearable for local people, I think, because of all the visitors and so on. We had... So the focus was measuring the cultural value of the New Contemporaries exhibition as a platform for emerging artists. Okay, there's a number of partners to the project, all the art schools in Scotland, but also the schools of architecture as well. I thought it was extremely important to cross those different divides. So behind the whole notion of the Royal Scottish Academy New Contemporaries exhibition is this notion of selection in collaboration with art and architectural schools. And in fact, our research team were invited to a selection process itself to see how the whole mechanism was actually operationalised. Where exhibitors were selected upon not the academic mark that they're awarded at art school or at the degree show, but in terms of their visualization, their idea generation, sparking something different in the minds of the creator and the audience and so on. And so they were then invited to develop a body of work and then showcase what they did with their peers as critics, as friends and so on. And then exhibiting within this New Contemporaries exhibition as a platform for promotion and debate beyond the usual degree show itself. So there were some 60 different graduates who went forward who are selected towards this. The exhibition itself, we attended the opening night. A number of gallerists were there, curators, collectors, the general public, family, friends, and so on. And the exhibition itself was generating around about 800 visits per day, and a lot of press and interest as well. So, this is Johnny Lyons, one of the prize-winning artists from the exhibition. He looks quite extrovert there, but when you actually interview the chap, he's quite introverted and quite shy, so it's kind of a clash of imagery there, I think, going on. And this is a shot from the opening night. It actually appeared in the front page of the Times newspaper as well. So you can get an idea of the space in the exhibition itself. Lots of space to move around, to think, create, value, and so on. So I'm just going to pull up the slides here for a second, and then I'll continue to talk about value creation. So, in our original research on cultural value, we developed a rationale for the promotion of policy on enhancing the opportunities for emerging artists to advance their careers, including recommendations for cultural value enhancement through entrepreneurial thinking and practice. The ability of wider arts and cultural experiences to transform people is also of central interest to cultural policy and practice. So I'm paying tribute here to people like Radborn, Glow, and Johansson, for example. So when you attend an art exhibition, it's obvious there's lots of energy about the place. So the transformative energy of the arts and culture is enabled in art through its inherent symbolic value as well. So we, in the Cultural Value Project, we looked at all sorts of different values beyond the economic, but acknowledging it. So the symbolic value in itself can be deemed entrepreneurial in that change is also being effected here. And then by critiquing the notion of art as a product, which I've already said can be contentious, but I think that's exciting as well, we can problematize its various dimensions of value, including that to society more generally. And something that really excites me and interests me and has done for the last few years is looking at market creation rather than market following activities. And I think that can provide sometimes innovative solutions that fight against stagnant audience numbers and programs which fail to appeal to new potential audiences in this era of equality and diversity. So talking of which, I refer to the next slide, and I had the great pleasure to visit the Museum of Old and New Art in Tasmania just over 4 years ago. I take it many of you in this room have been there. Anyone not been there yet? Please go. You have to go. It's fantastic. I went with my colleague to the museum. It's almost like a James Bond experience because most of the museum is below ground level. You can drive to it, but you can also approach it by boat. The boat is painted in camouflage design. It's also got a caged parrot that talks to you as well. So you've got the whole experience of value creation thing going on there. It's just amazing. And of course, there's the guy himself. We've done lots of work on David Walsh. This talk is not about David Walsh per se, but we're just fascinated by how this guy thinks, creates, believes, perceives opportunities, and creates value, and so on. So, this value-adding aspect, more generally, can be problematic to ascertain, since arts and cultural products are difficult to value due to the particular personal experiences of the stakeholders involved. Value here can also take a number of forms, originating in the instrumental aspects of social, economic, and policy outcomes relating to arts and cultural organizations and governance. And we had this debate the other day when we went to the book launch, and I'm pleased to reiterate it here, long-standing government measurement of the arts has tended to adhere to these dimensions because they can often be reported and measured in a quantified way. Isn't that exciting? Isn't it? But the Cultural Value Project has promoted awareness of and uncovered additional qualitative pathways which may be more difficult to assess, but hey, they are no less important. These include intrinsic, aesthetic, symbolic, and authentic value, as well as the cultural consumption of audiences and other stakeholders, where value is often realised in aesthetic, sensual, pleasurable ways which succeed in moving beyond everyday exchange and use value. And also more excitingly, entrepreneurial behaviour among creators of arts and culture, as well as their audiences, can also be realised through the processes of co-creation or the co-production of value. By understanding how value is created and sustained in art networks and relationships, we can improve our chances of reaching a heightened understanding of the true value of the arts more generally. So by thinking in an entrepreneurial way, we can view the arts and culture as a dynamic product, going back to this product notion again, as we move between producer, consumer, and other stakeholder perspectives. So let's go into more detail on the contribution of the cultural value dimensions already identified. Art and cultural value meanings are socially constructed and contextualized, and so we must move beyond long-held instrumental conventions to really understand what is happening here. Burzman, for example, considers that there are four motivators that drive arts and cultural consumption: functional or cultural, symbolic, social, and emotional. Furthermore, she argues that art consumers must be seen as co-producers in the art process, and that artistic experience should be the core customer value. In addition to co-production, the interrelated nature of the arts and cultural market, where supply chain members like museums, for example, act as legitimizing agents for a product's reputation, meaning there are numerous interested stakeholders that need to be considered in any analysis of the dynamics of the market. So why don't we also focus on the ability of the artist as an entrepreneur, use that as a data source to inform us about marketplace transformations and lead us to novel insights into managing in the arts and cultural arena? So-called famous or celebrity artists can provide some illumination here. So let us consider then the impact of the celebrity artist on arts and cultural production and consumption activities. So we could, for example, use the artist entrepreneur Thomas Kincaid to illustrate this. Has everyone heard of Thomas Kincaid? At one time, he was, shall we call it, America's most successful living artist. Yes, he went to art school. Yes, he dropped out of art school. Yes, he built a business model. And he successfully created a following of a community of consumers who believed in the value, the ethos, the aura of what he was producing. And that's what he produced. So you might not see this in any reputable gallery, but American consumers and consumers all around the world have bought his original artwork, his reproductions. And the guy died 10 years ago, still making his artwork. And his company is signing his signature with DNA from his blood. At least that's the story. So how entrepreneurial is that? So what he's been doing there, authenticity and nostalgia dimensions are clearly influential factors in terms of generating his success. Underpinning these relationships are the roles played out by the media, including communication of celebrity artist identity and the catalyzing of its commodification within the celebrity artist brand scape. An enduring celebrity brand results due to the market creation activities of the celebrity artist. Artists can create markets, so can art entrepreneurs. David Walsh, again, who successfully created Mona, can be held up as an example of someone who challenges the status quo, does what he wants with the resources at his disposal, and differentiates his offering in the marketplace. By sometimes, not all the time, but sometimes dismissing an administrative approach to arts marketing and arts management more generally, a more entrepreneurially creative approach can pay dividends if the circumstances allow. We can also learn from how we research the arts from academic and practitioner perspectives. Look, for example, at the growing body of critical arts marketing research. Alan Bradshaw from Royal Holloway in London reviews some of the relevant arts marketing literature in order to reconsider its methodologies and the relationship between art and marketing. He identifies a growing body of work urging arts marketers to continue to adopt long accepted marketing principles in order to satisfy their customers. However, he also notes the multi-directional impact of arts marketing, from positivist interpretations to more creative revisualizations where art and literary theory can be used to inform marketing. So this position which he adopts also fits with my own way of thinking as well in terms of the meaning, practice and contribution of arts marketing, marketing in art and art in marketing. Bradshaw divides his review into sections on the consumption of art and the connections with aesthetics and the simultaneous production and consumption of art. Marketing as art, Stephen Brown, an esteemed professor at University of Ulster as well, has done lots of work in this area. Art as marketing, Jonathan Schroeder as well from the US of A, which I've worked with as well, does a lot of good work on this. And marketing interpreting art itself. Bradshaw adopts a consumption focus, whereas I concentrate more on the role of the artist as an entrepreneur and the organization in shaping arts marketing, but also marketing theory, small business theory, and so on. And what really excites me is this, by doing this, it attempts to close this gap between theory and practice. As an academic, it's so easy to teach from the textbook and talk about your research, but you don't really acknowledge this gap in knowledge between theory and practice so much. And that's one of my key aims. So we can look forward, but we can also look backwards. Historical insight into arts marketing practice, which identifies both stable and emerging theoretical constructs, is welcome. For example, a longitudinal investigation of artistic competencies. Aesthetic concerns should also be considered alongside the need to attract sizable audiences in order to generate income. So future research should therefore investigate the interplay between the aesthetic impact of innovative output and the perceived need for market orientation. Since artists and the art they create often consist of intangible factors and abstract concepts, they don't tend to lend themselves well to conventional marketing research problems. I have recommended elsewhere the use of other modes of inquiry, such as the utilization of entrepreneurial marketing, biographical methodology, and other narrative approaches, in order to better understand how the individual practices his or her own form of marketing. And I encourage others to carry on this work as well, because what it does is it uncovers a large body of data that would otherwise remain hidden. We can learn about the transformative energy of the arts and culture by interrogating the data located within artistic sources. So, for example, I have acquired insight into idea generation, creativity, and an improved understanding of the clashes between art for art's sake versus art for business sake by attending performances, reading the texts concerning the lives of fictional and real artists and other creative practitioners as well. So researching into artistic practice, arts marketing, small business marketing, entrepreneurship, and creativity has persuaded me of the merits of historical research as well as contemporary data collection. So look forward, look backwards, and move together. That's my philosophy. But then why not also consider how an entrepreneurial lens can help us understand how innovation in the arts and cultural arena can not only transform practices in the industry, but also reach out to other sectors in informing best practice in management more widely. An entrepreneurial lens can also inform our research methodologies. So I'm thinking here in terms of looking at artistic competencies. I've done a number of studies where these competencies hold true across different sectors and over time as well. So I think this is much more exciting than teaching from the textbook. The arts, rather than the sciences, have long been viewed as higher ways of gaining knowledge, while art itself can suggest innovative hypotheses which would otherwise be unlikely to occur through analytical scientific thinking alone. Also, art contains a claim to truth which is no less inferior to that of science. It also provides a more complete, multidimensional and multisensory perspective to understanding, rather than focusing on explanation alone. Artistic ways of thinking have existed alongside scientific perspectives for centuries, if not millennia. Long before the current debate on rational versus non-rational ways of knowing, Vico and Baumgarten promoted poetic wisdom or non-rational sensing over logical deductive thinking. The art and management movement also suggests the ability to draw on unusual combinations and juxtapositions. Viewing management as an artistic phenomenon adds a critical tone to the debate, since art is often concerned with reflection and pushing the boundaries of thinking. The notion of critical thinking relates to the breaking down, uncovering, unveiling, and analysis of dominant imagery and icons. So, I have considered a variety of pathways into understanding how the entrepreneurial energy of the arts and culture can change the ways of managing culture. Perhaps the creativity inherent in cultural value provides us with a way to achieve this and in helping us address the change in the economy recently, moving from knowledge-based activities to creativity, innovation, entrepreneurship and imagination. Creativity enables the artist entrepreneur to act on these opportunities in ways which can result in competitive advantage. So embracing some business terminology there. It can provide the basis for innovation and growth, as well as impacting positively on society more generally. Creativity has been viewed as the construction of ideas or products which are new and potentially useful. Although in an entrepreneurial sense, there should also be a subsequent link to innovation and profitability in monetary and social terms. These ideas can be internally or externally located, although the entrepreneur will tend to search and identify potential solutions shaped in part by internal competencies. Creativity here allows the organization to take advantage of opportunities which develop as the result of these changing environmental conditions. So, to sum up, the possibilities are boundless. Open your eyes, seek new opportunities, learn from each other, share with each other. Think like an artist, but be an entrepreneur. Thank you.
Thank you, Ian, for that provocative and fascinating presentation. I'd like to invite our panellists to come and sit up here, and Ian, you might want to sit up there as well. Or the first person I'm going to hand over to is Sandy Vershaw, who's the Deputy Mayor, City of Adelaide, a board director at the Adelaide Festival Centre, an executive producer of the Festival of Ideas, which has just finished. A tour de force in the arts with many strings to her bow that demonstrate the value that she's created for festivals, the Festival Centre and local government, to name a few, and an alumnus of the Arts Management Program at the University of South Australia. So without further ado, Sandy.
Thank you. Yes, it was actually, sadly, it's coming up nearly 30 years since I came here to do the arts administration course. I didn't work in the arts at all at the time, had never worked in the arts. And the very first thing that we were asked to say is, why are you doing this course? What's that? And I said, I want to market the Adelaide Festival of Arts. And there was a collective laugh around the room. And 3 years later, 4 years later, I contacted some of my fellow students and said, guess what, I'm the marketing manager for the Adelaide Festival of the Arts. And that was it. And so that's sort of a long time that I've been there working in the arts, and I absolutely love it. The Adelaide Festival of Ideas is in a slightly different space, and I know some of you have been there over the weekend. I hope you enjoyed it. But we explore all manner of subjects: space, artificial intelligence, environment, blockchain. I finally think I get it. Artificial intelligence, social entrepreneurship, physiology, psychology, law, B Corps, gender, identity, human rights, language, cities, housing. There was so much going on. It was great, quite explosive for my brain, and I loved it. And for 20 years, the Adelaide Festival idea has, you know, tried to be very hard to be that gathering point for that exchange and of ideas and a celebration of life, really, of the mind. This year, we actually came up with something else that we wanted to do, and that's we had a dedicated theme running through the program, which is Art Equals Ideas. And really, it was, you know, alongside this dedicated program of talks and debate and conversations, we also wanted to celebrate the rich life of the mind as explored and expressed through art. There were many things that we were able to present over that weekend, one of which was the many conversations around cultural value, one of which was the book, What Matters, Talking Value in Australian Culture by Julian Merrick, Tully Burnett and Robert Fidian. And I've had lots of discussions with the University of South Australia and the other people who are researching that art and in that area. And I guess part of me always gets frustrated about that constant value debate, you know, about statistics, about what we measure, how we measure it. And a lot of the conversations over these last few days have really been, until art is looked at as necessary. So at the moment, even the funding is discretionary. If you look at government funding, arts falls in the discretionary bucket. Until it becomes something that is valued like we do education or health or science, then I don't know how we get away from this commerce versus culture sort of ongoing discussions about the economic return. If we do want to talk about economic return, there is one thing that Adelaide does seem to get, and that's its festivals. So, and a few years ago, I was part of the group that established Festivals Adelaide, which was to be a voice of advocacy for the 10 major arts festivals, the Adelaide Festival, Adelaide Fringe, Sala, AusAsia, Guitar Festival, Dream Big, Cabaret Feast, WOM Adelaide and Film Festival, and the History Festival has just also joined that collective. This year, 2018, collectively, those festivals returned something in order of $76 million in new money and a gross economic expenditure of $262 million. Now, that's just here in South Australia, and they are extraordinary figures. It was also over 800 full-time jobs. So, you know, is that the best measure that we can come up with? And I really enjoyed your presentation, Ian, and particularly when you talk about the entrepreneurship of artists. I was a past CEO of both the Adelaide Fringe and the Adelaide Festival. In the Adelaide Fringe, there is no better example anywhere that I can think of where you are looking at arts entrepreneurship. There are, I think the number is something like 6,900 artists at the last Fringe Festival and over 1,200 events. And every single thing that is in that program is somebody taking a risk, because it is an open platform, which means the artists are taking the risks to put in their show. For some reason, they want to share their art with us. And what they want is everybody to take away a great experience. So again, it goes, what are we actually measuring here? Are we just measuring the economic return and which is based on a ticket sale or based on an airfare or a hotel accommodation, whereas actually what they're doing is, you know, besides the actual economic impact, which we all have to research as people in the arts, what they're actually doing is creating these incredible experiences. And as you know, Adelaide has got a wonderful reputation as being that city, a cultural city, and based on a lot about its festivals, and we're working with UniSA on festivals in terms of degrees. And but I look at it slightly differently. So I would love to come up with a measure for experience. Can I just ask who in the room has travelled outside of Adelaide? How many of you travelled outside of Australia? Okay, so when we travel, I hope my circle of friends is broad enough, but we talk about where did you go, what did you see, what experience did you have? So when you come back, the discussion is all about the experience that they've had over there. And what everybody wants is a creative one. It's about fine grain, it's about local, it's about authentic. It's the, I can't get this anywhere else, right? And that's why you go to that city for that. And the cities all build their reputations on that. And we also, as a city, have built our reputation on a lot of things we have done, particularly in festivals and in the creation of art. I ran for council because I wanted to make sure that there was a cultural strategy and that creativity hadn't dropped off, because I had been there as a general manager 3 years looking after that portfolio of culture and community services, and I was really scared that having stepped away that things can sort of disappear pretty quickly if you don't have a strong voice in the chamber. And it really was to make sure that... So the pillars were, when I stepped in, the strategic plan that was about to be endorsed was smart, livable and green. And we pulled it. It was the very first thing I did as a member of council, pulled the report, said, can we just have another look at it? And so they put a fourth pillar, which was creative. And there was a lot of work done in a fairly short period of time. And since then, we've done a cultural strategy and a public art strategy. We've got the UNESCO City of Music designation, and there's a whole, you know, force behind that, not just from the council, obviously, from Art South Australia and all the people that are working in the music industry. From the perspective of a city that I would love to live in, I'm not quite sure how I would measure that, but I want to live in a creative city. And so, you know, what if there was, you know, a fund like Paul Keating established years ago, where you had, you know, 10 or 20 you know, mid-career artists who are actually given that support, that financial support of a grant of $50,000 a year or something, and said, okay, here's the caveat. You have to work in film or music or dance or literature or poetry or philosophy. You have to live here at least 50% of the time. You have to collaborate with people that are here on the ground, and you have to present or premiere your work here. I actually think in a very small space of time, it would really change some of the things that are happening in the city. And how would we measure that? We'd measure it by the experience that we're having in the city, and everybody that comes to visit us would measure it by the experience they have by being in a city that has creative energy. And those creative energy, you know when you're there. Everybody can feel it. You know when you're in a creative city. That's what I want for the city. And so it's fascinating that entrepreneurship is not a word that artists use about themselves, ever. And it's sort of looking at that thing of, you know, inspiration, perspiration. I look at Sean because, you know, in terms of, you know, what ADT has done in the last little while, there's a huge amount of perspiration there. And persistence. And that what we can do through entrepreneurship, though, is help those successful creatives go from being on their own to be successful creative enterprises. And that's sort of the area that I also would be really interested to play in, and what that also does for the city in which we live, and the city that we all want to live in. Thank you.
Sorry. Thank you, Sandy. Our next panellist is John Oster, the Executive Director of Regional Arts Australia, based in Alice Springs. It's really important to have that regional voice. John is also an alumnus of the Arts Management Program at UniSA and an advocate and renowned expert of long standing for Aboriginal arts and regional value. John.
What a pleasure to be here. And Ian, thank you so much for your talk. It's just a bundle of ideas there. And what I'm going to try and do is just get a grab bag of things and to respond to. But I want to finish up with a couple of tensions and finish up on Aboriginal art, because there's some real ironies there. Talking about value, I'm not sure if you're aware, but the Australian Bureau of Statistics in 2014 released some research on the value of the arts in Australia. Anyone aware of that? It's phenomenal. $58 billion per year in gross value add to our economy, about 4% of GDP, roughly equal to retail trade, roughly equal, or better than, agriculture and fisheries, and still the arts is regarded as, you know, the poor relation in our economy. And so, you know, I think it's incumbent upon all of us to promote this, and we do. But, you know, the Australian government doesn't really want to talk about this. There are other things like energy and like politics and like the tensions within government, transport. And so when you go and ask government for more money here, you know, it's not a proposition. And they've closed down this research. They're not funding that kind of research anymore by the ABS. And the Department of Arts and Culture, Communications and the Arts in Canberra is having to gear up its own research to try and fill that gap. I operate in the small to medium sector in regional arts. These are small companies, small artists, small community organisations spread right across Australia. We manage the Regional Arts Fund, which distributes about $3 million to arts projects in regional Australia. It's a very small fund, but it's a valuable fund. And when we go to the government, as we do, to increase that fund, we don't find ourselves arguing for the value of the arts. What we find ourselves arguing for is more resilient communities and a better life in regional Australia, and the intrinsic value of the arts is something that, you know, government, again, isn't particularly interested in. I just want to go to the impact thing and mention some areas where research is really important. Closing the gap is something that's been a great problem in Australia forever, but since Kevin Rudd embarked on the closing the gap process, we've generally been unable to meet our targets. We've failed miserably in meeting those targets. And they are targets in education, health, longevity, and they need to be measurable. The government comes out with its report every year. How are we closing this gap? These are the numbers, and we are measuring how we are doing that. And this has become quite a failing, and the government's recognised that failing recently and has done a closing the gap refresh, where they've gone around the country and consulted with Aboriginal people and many people in the community and different branches of government to try and refresh and get more stimulus into meeting those targets. One of the things that Aboriginal people have put to this is that it needs to be a recognition of culture. And Closing the Gap has not recognised culture as an intrinsic strand or element that can contribute to better outcomes in health and better outcomes in education. And I mean, it's really simple, I think, that if education outcomes need to be better, to be able to educate people in their own language and educate people with cultural sensitivity is just a no-brainer from my point of view. However, many Aboriginal groups responded to the notion that culture should be included as a driver of closing the gap. And it seems that the Department of Prime Minister and Cabinet's not open to that because essentially it can't be measured. How can we measure these things? And I think there's a lot of work being done that you've referred to, Ian, and elsewhere, to try and get more quantitative measurements of impact. One of those is happening in local government at the moment, where the Australia Council and the federal government are encouraging local government to take on cultural development plans and strategies, include them in their business plans. And again, measurement is important. So there is an organisation based in Melbourne called the Cultural Development Network who is working to try and solve this problem, try and measure cultural impact. They've developed a new white box technology which comes in at the beginning when a local government creates its strategic plan and then builds in measurement factors along the way and is trying to present that. The other area we think it's really important is in creative well-being. Another way of saying this is arts and health. In short, the important contribution that arts can make to well-being. Some off-the-cuff examples are singing helps dementia. There's UK research that says particular arts programs can reduce doctor visits by 30%. It's an important area that we haven't gone into, and in 2014, the federal government and the state governments, both arts and health sides of the equation, developed the National Arts and Health Framework that everyone was going to sign up to. Sadly, the momentum of that is lost, and we are trying to revive that and do some things. But I want to quickly come to some attentions. I've been to Tasmania a lot recently and come across the Mona effect. The Mona effect is a really interesting phenomenon because it depends who you talk to about what sort of effect it has. If you talk to the Tasmanian government, the Mona effect is fantastic and we will support Mona and we've got Dark Mofo and we've got FOMA Mona and all the other things because Mona brings tourism and excitement to Tasmania, and that's unchallenged. But when you talk to these small to medium arts organisations in Tasmania, there's quite a different effect. And I think Walsh has done an incredible thing, an entrepreneurship amazing, but, you know, ticks and crosses, you know, emerging artists, crosses. Policy development, a few crosses there because Walsh has got some policy development that helps him build a new casino in Tasmania. Interesting. It loses money, cross. Local employment, cross. Local arts groups, the life sucked out of them, cross. But big entrepreneurship, it is fantastic from a tourist point of view. It brings money in. And that's one of the tensions. I do want to finish on Aboriginal art because there's an incredible irony here. Small to medium arts organisations aren't particularly entrepreneurial, and Aboriginal arts organisations generally aren't either. But there's been a lot of tension in the Aboriginal art market for the last 10 years or so. There have been inquiries. There have been all sorts of government interventions to try and promote fair trade in Aboriginal art. The latest one is the fake art campaign, which is dealing with the imports of supposed Aboriginal art coming in from China and what to do about that. The value in Aboriginal art is authenticity. If you ask Aboriginal people, as I have continually, what do you want from your art? Why do you do your art? They don't do it to make money. Their interest is their kids and their culture. How can we educate our kids? And let's face it, the population rate of people in Aboriginal people under the age of 35 is just exploding. What to do about the kids? How can we bring them up in a traditional culture and give them cultural value? And keeping that cultural value alive is what Aboriginal artists are about. And there's another body of Aboriginal artists who are dealing with dealers who are chasing the buck. And what we find is that those Aboriginal artists who aren't so worried about the dollar and the authenticity of their work goes up, so the value goes up. And they are able to produce incredible artworks. The latest is an amazing project that's going to go into the Australian War Museum. And I think the museum has paid thousands and thousands of dollars for this artwork that will go in the hall next to the, I don't know if you've been there, but you know, the Gallipoli boat is the big thing as you walk in, and opposite that is going to be these phenomenal two pieces of Aboriginal art that have been done in the past couple of years. Those that chase the buck find their value goes down and down and down and down because they're generally caught up with shonky dealers who are just trying to push out volume all the time. So those that don't chase the buck get the buck. We'll stop on that. It's a silly place to stop, but thank you.
I'd now like to introduce Sean Comerford, the Executive Director of the Australian Dance Theatre, an innovative contemporary dance company responsible for the new 2018 Adelaide Dance Festival and, of course, the move to the Odeon Theatre in Norwood. The value ADT has created is evident in these innovations as the company seeks to develop Adelaide audiences rather than just international ones. Sean, I'll hand over to you.
Yes, as Ruth mentioned, we're pretty busy at the moment. We are in the middle of our first dance festival. We are in the middle of a national tour. We have just finished completing a move to the Odeon Theatre in Norwood. And it's good times. It's a great time to be involved with the company. I would like to tell a bit of a story, I guess, about the last few years with ADT. I joined ADT in 2015, and I came to the company from a very different place. I'm probably more of an entrepreneur than an arts manager. I joined ADT from the commercial musical sector. I moved over from Sydney. My most recent role was putting together the Asia Tour of Les Miserables for Cameron McIntosh. And I came to Adelaide and ADT with at a time when the company was experiencing, I guess, one of its more controversial times. ADT, being 53 years old this year, is no stranger to controversy. The company has had its ups and downs, I guess most notoriously known for numerous artistic directors who had left the company in strange circumstances across a 50-year period. And with that, I guess, brings opportunity to redefine a story and a narrative and move to where we are today, which is in a very strong place. So I joined, as I said, at the end of 2015. The company's celebrated its 50th year anniversary. And this was a headline in the advertiser. It was talking about the company's 50th year gala that was cancelled. It was not a happy place for the company at the time. We skip forward 3 years, and this is a very different headline. This is a headline that talks about The company moving from strength to strength, to the Odeon Theatre having secured significant government funding to make possible a space for dance, an international choreographic centre, and a home for Australia's oldest contemporary dance company. I guess one of the key things we looked at when we moved here was the first solution being repairing the narrative around the company, trying to be entrepreneurial but be accessible, being the people that, from a media point of view, were always available for a photo, always available for TV coverage. We are a visual medium. We have capacity to, I guess, reach an audience in a very different way. And as such, we can be in demand for media exposure, but part of that is being ready and willing and able. And so we change that narrative internally as well as externally. We also want it to be easy to work with. Internally, ADT has a number of great collaborators, and we've collaborated fantastically from an artistic point of view. But collaborating locally with other arts organisations, with your funding body, with the independent sector was really important. Thirdly, was listening to what people say. One of the things we started a few years ago was a forum where we engaged with the independent dance sector called Meeting at the Dance Hall. And from that forum, understanding what support a company like ADT could provide to the independent sector and to other arts organisations, we developed a little bit of a strategy that looked at developing opportunities such as we're living at the moment, our dance festival, and a space where work can be performed more regularly. An interesting element to what we've done over the last few years has been acquiring new partners. This photo is an interesting one in particular. At the time, we needed something that was going to be a fun image for the paper. Our publicist grabbed a bunch of boxes from National Storage, and we were able to get that. I think it was page 3 in the teaser. Flash forward 6 months later, we use that picture to pitch to National Storage and attract a major partner by saying, hey, look, we've got your boxes in the paper. How about a discussion about finding a way to help our storage solutions? That in-kind partnership is worth somewhere in the vicinity of $40,000 to $80,000 a year to us now. We've moved all of our storage across to National Storage. They've been excellent partners. Partnerships are always an important part of any arts organisation, particularly small to medium organisations. And, you know, the topic of value has been discussed at length this evening. And I guess value is something quite different to each person, to each arts organisation, to each potential sponsor. One of the things we did a few years ago was have conversations with our existing partners. What value can we give to you? And coming from a commercial background where value from a commercial musical partnership is very different to what an arts organisation can offer. You know, when I worked on Jersey Boys for a number of years, and you know, a ticket that's worth $150 has a certain value to it. You can look at our marketing budgets of a commercial musical and say, okay, well, a partnership with us is going to mean exposure through, you know, $1 million marketing budget, and then, you know, a couple of $100,000 spend a week. Small to medium arts organisations often operate on a very different scale. So I had conversations with existing partners, many of which who are still with us and some who aren't, about what they were getting out of working with ADT. Was it a social responsibility aspect? Was it, did you like to bring people to come and see dance performances? What was the real deliverable? And the answers weren't great. They were, we don't really know, you know, it's this, that was from a relationship. There was a CFO that was part of this company a few years ago, and they really liked dance, and one of their daughter danced with the youth ensemble, and so that's why we sponsor you. Those aren't good conversations to have, because if there's no value being perceived by the partner, how are you going to retain a partner? So we looked at interesting and innovative ways to return some value to our partners. A key one for us was our conversations with SA Power Networks, who we've been working with for a number of years. We brainstormed between myself and the sponsorship manager there ways in which we could use our IP and our resources, which as a small to medium organisation are limited, to deliver something that was going to make sense to a utilities company, because I didn't get the relationship between a utilities company and a dance company. What we came up with was the use of our dancers as a resource in that their capacity to understand their own bodies and solve their, I guess, occupational health and safety aspect made a lot of sense to a company that have a workforce of people climbing up and down power poles and putting themselves into physical danger, but also getting short soft tissue injuries. So pulled hamstrings and sore backs is something that's really common, apparently, in the utility sector. So we developed a series of workshops where ADT's dancers and our associate artistic director would provide an insight into how they are mentally prepared for work, how they work as a team, and how they physically prepare from a stretching point of view, and passed that on to the physio teams and some of the internal health and safety teams within SA Power Networks. So that was great. We acquired another great sponsor in Adelaide Airport, and Adelaide Airport have a need to find content for their new screens, and ADT as a company that creates content and creates moving image and creates interesting artwork thought this would be a really great fit. So I've actually got a little video to show you next. This is a video that we put together. Adelaide Airport is the only mainland airport in Australia that has free trolleys, and a lot of people don't know that, and I travel a lot, and when you travel a lot you do know that, because you know that you can get to Melbourne and it's $4 or $6 and you use a trolley for 7 minutes, it's really annoying. Whereas I think Adelaide Airport, because they've got free trolleys, it's really undersold, and we found a way to show that in an interesting aspect. This video is really interesting because it ticks a lot of boxes for us. We're servicing a relationship with a partner. We are creating career pathway opportunities for our dancers, because two of our dancers actually choreographed this dance. And ADT is an interesting proposition in our reach in Adelaide. We perform less than most of the other Adelaide arts companies. We tour a lot, and so we perform maybe one or two seasons a year in South Australia. But we have a massive international reach. We have a larger social media following than the three major performing arts companies in South Australia combined. We had 2.5 million video views online last year. And I think social media-wise, we are somewhere in the vicinity of about 65,000 followers. So this video, when it was put onto Adelaide Airport's social media channels, quickly became their largest post that they'd put up. I think it was seen by about 60,000 people within the space. Video also serviced another partnership that we have with the Adelaide College of the Arts. Our dance ensemble was filled out with additional dancers from the Adelaide College of the Arts. So that was an output that had, you know, a three-pronged success story. What successful partnerships like that have been able to do has been to elevate the brand and put us on a raised platform. In the last 6 to 9 months, we've attracted some other premium brands, one being that Henschke Wines have joined ADT as a sponsor of the Henschke Wine Bar, which is a new bar in our new home in the Odeon. I guess visibility and storytelling go hand in hand. You know, having a narrative to hone and sit alongside of what we do in the art is a massive part of our success. We were approached about 9 months ago by the Cunard Cruise Lines, you know, an international cruise line. I'd been on a cruise many years ago in my youth on a totally different cruise line, but didn't know much about Cunard except that they were the best. They had the Queen Elizabeth, the Queen Mary too, and they were the very big ships that pulled into Sydney Harbour that stopped everyone to look. They approached us with the idea that they, for the first time, Cunard were going to have a ship based out of Australia for a full season, so for I think it's about 90 days next year, and they wanted to partner with some iconic Australian brands as they perceived them, and they talked about Akubra, RM Williams, Starwood Whiskey from Victoria, which is a well-known whiskey in whiskey circles. It won an international whiskey competition a few years ago, and Australian Dance Theatre. That sort of turnaround for a brand that was, you know, mired in controversy a few years ago to be securing a relationship with Cunard Cruise Lines is significant. So next March, ADT will be a feature entertainment on a particular cruise in Australian waters on the Queen Elizabeth. It'll be an immersive experience where guests get to watch two performances of our newest work at the end of the cruise, but we'll also get to be up close and personal with the company and listen to talks and go to classes and have an up close and personal experience. Cunard, doing what they do, love to make some wonderful videos as well, so we worked with them to create a range of different videos to help sell the cruises, but we announced this in February, I think it was, in Sydney. So here's a little clip about that. So I guess to wrap up, the key things for me is that we've been entrepreneurs in what we've done for the company, specifically around finding ways to tell our stories better. When creative organisations are storytellers anyway, but often there can be that divide between the management side of an organisation and the artistic side of the organisation. We've taken a whole of organisation approach to the way we've approached partnerships, international exposure, everything that we do now is very much the entire organisation. And you're utilising your best skills. We're utilising our creative teams to be able to come up with interesting concepts like that. A little side note to the Adelaide Airport one is that 10 days ago, ADT was the first company to, I believe the first company, to film on the tarmac at Adelaide Airport between 11:30 and 4 a.m., Saturday a week ago, we filmed a new video for them in between two very large planes using their benches, and it's a kind of a stretching video which will be interesting. It'll be coming out pretty soon. So again, we get to have fun doing these things, but these deliver great value to the organisation. So we get to be, you know, a little bit creative and entrepreneurial at the same time. So thank you.
Thank you, Sean. What I'd like to do is to ask our panel and our key speaker, Ian, to come up here so that we can have you ask questions, make comments, but participate in the conversation about value and share what you know. All right, are there questions from you at the floor? Yes, Grant.
Hi, I'm going to play the devil's advocate a little bit. For arts organisations, when they hear the terms arts entrepreneurship, particularly from government funders or ministers or bureaucrats, they tend to hear in the background notions around do more with less, do more commercial work, add a cafe to your art gallery, this sort of thing that potentially might take away from the core mission of the organisation or the general artistic vision. Can you discuss those notions around the fears that arts organisations might have around the whole idea of entrepreneurship in the arts?
Do you want to direct that to a particular person, Grant?
No, I'll just throw it open.
Open, right.
There's great danger here, isn't there? Because arts organisations typically, in the world that I live in, are small to medium organisations and don't have a lot of capacity or, you know. So in my experience, there's an organisation in Queensland who decided to get entrepreneurial and decided to buy, with their reserves, an old wool store, and we will have our offices here and we will lease out the space so that other organisations can rent it and create an income for us, and we'll have a gallery and we'll have a cafe. But the decisions they made about it were really awful. They put it in one of the areas where there are no people through the day. The costs were incredible. When I went there several times, there were no more than two people in the cafe. So, you know, it's about expertise, isn't it? And we've all seen organisations that have gone off away from their mission and away from their values and suffered for it.
I think it's an interesting thing where, you know, having been in lots of companies of varying sort of with varying resources, I think at the I understand what you're saying, because at the base of it, I think all artists are entrepreneurial because they're all taking risks and they're all putting themselves out there constantly. It's a word that doesn't resonate with most of the artists that I know and most of the arts companies that I know. Because what you're saying is the expectation is that they step outside of what they do into a different world. And not everything can be fixed with a bar, unfortunately, or a cafe. There is an expectation, I guess, that arts companies are not so reliant on funding. And that and the entrepreneurship or entrepreneurial conversation are two different conversations. And so, you know, I guess it is a danger. It's a danger because it takes them away from actually what they're there to do, you know, create a piece of theatre, create a piece of dance, create a piece of art. But the other side of it is we all struggle with artists who are also expected to be business managers. So that sort of, that basic skilling up is also something we need to be very mindful of.
I think there's a real balance. Some of my favourite days are days when my artistic director and I sit in a room together and argue the merits of what we're doing. You know, whether this particular sponsor activation is detracting from more time in our next creative development. And it's one of those ongoing challenges and struggles with arts organisations. We, as a company, we're in a similar funding position to where the company was 10 years ago. Obviously, things have gotten more expensive, but the funding hasn't gone up. So you do have to find new ways in which to bring in resources to create opportunities for what you do. I think fundamentally, and this is my ongoing conversation with our AD, is that everything that we do leads towards our key goal, which is creating amazing work and letting it be seen by more and more people, nationally and internationally. And if we have to, in some capacity, give a little to partners or supporters or whatever it may be, I think that is part of the balance of the organisations. But when we look at, I guess, from the varying struggle for resources in the small to medium. We're a small to medium organisation. We're one of the largest small to medium organisations, but you know, we still are competing in the same world as organisations who have marketing departments that are as big as our entire company. So you're competing with them for sponsors and for donors, and so you have to find interesting ways to create relationships with people.
I was just going to add, when I was the exec producer for Windmill Theatre Company, resourcing is also, because you still need money, you know, entrepreneurship, rule 101 is, you know, cash is king. You still actually need the money to be able to do. But I remember when we were doing Pinocchio and Rumpelstiltskin, sort of big musical productions, I actually wanted the experience for the consumer to be from the minute they walked in the door, so that they would step into a world that was, you know, the world of Rumpelstiltskin, and, you know, right through to sort of the ushers being in costume or whatever. And it was really hard to do because of the resourcing that allowed us to do it. But if we'd pulled it off, that experience would have been talked about forever. Does that make sense? So it's sort of, it's again, it's always that thing of trying to find the resources to do that, because again, it goes back to me, the experience that you want people to have, which is more holistic. So
I would agree with your comments there. Probably suggest take the artist out of the gallery, move to different environments and so on. And I'm just thinking about one of my doctoral dissertation I supervised a few years ago in Venezuela. It was about the pre and post Chavez regime, and how artists were not allowed to exhibit in art galleries anymore because Chavez had packed the galleries with his own artwork. So they set up reactionary venues in communities, in garages, in the street, and performed there instead. And I think that also addresses it's not just a British problem, and possibly a white problem generally. The usual audience for the arts in the UK is an ABC1 profile, and we're continually thinking about how do you get the non-attender to come to these events. Shift the location, do it somewhere else, perform it differently, and then you're going to communicate with different audiences and so on. That's what I would do.
Well, I'd like to suggest that because of the time, and there is more food to come and more alcohol as well, or non-alcoholic drinks, that we put our hands together and thank our keynote and panel members. And please make use of the time that we've got left to speak to our guests informally on the floor and share your ideas that way, and enjoy the food that's to come. Thank you.